best preseason in franchise. Comets are off to a 2-1 start. Pretty impressive, considering that all three games were played on the road to start the season in St. Louis, Baltimore, and New York. The Comets open the schedule this Wednesday night at home. And joining us right now is Comets head coach Rick Benben. I suppose you had to cringe a little bit to find out you were going to have to play the first three on the road. That's tough.
Oh, we certainly did. And, you know, you'd like to start off at home. In the past, we've always been able to, but with the season pushback. But certainly the way it's worked out, I think it's been to our advantage. And now we're looking forward to getting back home.
Well, even in the game you lost in Baltimore, you lost a relatively close game and one you had a chance to win right up to the end.
No, we did. And we played all three games we played good enough to win. And, you know, we're disappointed about that game and wish we could go back and do a few things different. But certainly 2-1 on that road trip was a good showing for us, and we're happy with it.
You've got a lot of new guys, and we're going to be talking about that in just a moment. But briefly, how tough is that to blend so many new faces together?
Well, it's very tough, and certainly I think we'll be a much better team a couple of months from now. But the most important thing is, of the new players, most of them are talented, and that outweighs the problem of getting it to blend together. So certainly some misunderstanding and better cohesiveness we'll have later has been overcome by some good individual performances here early.
Well, you've got some talent. Maybe the most talented team we've ever had. Well, let's put our phone number up for you once more on the screen. If you'd like to talk to Rick here in the next segment of the show, which will continue after the break, you can give us a call at 722-0549 and get a line right now. We'll talk a little bit of soccer with Rick Benben. We've got some good footage to show you, some interesting stories coming up on the Comets. That's going to do it for this edition of Sports Extra. Stay tuned now for the Comets Rated Tough, a 30-minute special on this year's team coming up in just a few moments.
Jensen.
Welcome back, and thanks for staying up with us. In our next half hour, we're going to take an in-depth look at this year's Comets team. Rick Benben will be back with us in a moment to take your calls, and we'll also have a close-up look at Gino Schiraldi, a profile of Gino, the last remaining member of the original Comets. And Jack Carey will have a special report tonight on four former Comets and what their lives are like without professional soccer. Well, as you know, it was a very busy off-season for the Comets front office with no less than 20 off-season transactions. So needless to say, there are plenty of new faces when the Comets take the Kemper Arena floor Wednesday night for the home opener.
Mitchell's out there. Stuart Lee's out on the power play. Lee's shot is off the glass. A rebound. Aramina goal. 2-0 Kansas City.
This will be a very different Comets team in 1986 because more than half the players who finished the season with the Comets are no longer with the team. Up front, the Comets have added high-scoring forward Jan Gusens, who led Minnesota to the championship series last year. And returning to Kansas City is forward Yilmaz Oron. The longtime crowd favorite is back after a three-year absence.
I'll be maybe a little bit emotional there, but I have to think about my team and myself and go out there and do my job. And then after the game when we win, then I'll go all around the Kemper and I just want to win, and that's all.
Another forward who may see action is Edmund Rogova, signed as a free agent from Yugoslavia.
Especially when you look at some players individually, I think that's one of the better teams in the league. So I hope if everything goes like supposed to be, I mean, without the injuries and things like that, we're going to do good this season.
Coach Rick Benben has beefed up his defense as well with the acquisition of Pittsburgh defender Charlie Green.
It's not just the defenders, it's really how the team plays defense as a whole. We have the forwards and the midfielders all coming back, and if we can get back behind the ball and everyone does their job, we're going to be tough to get through.
And perhaps the best man-to-man defender in the MISL, George Espinoza, who was purchased from Wichita in September. And another former wing, veteran midfielder Jorgen Christensen, was signed during the offseason. Christensen, a four-time MISL All-Star, helped bring two other Danish players to Kansas City. Defender Jens Busk and forward Martin Zimmermann, both on lease from their outdoor teams in Copenhagen.
We have played indoor in Denmark, but we play 4-on-4. And the goalkeepers must not take the ball with the hands. He must take with the head and something.
In goal, Alan Mayer remains from last year's squad, but former St. Louis Steamer Ed Gettemeyer has replaced Manny Schwartz.
The league has evolved to such a state that you have to have two guys that you can count on at any given time. So it's very similar to pitchers in baseball. You know, you don't have one star pitcher or, you know, one starting pitcher. You have many starting pitchers. In soccer, you should have two starting goalkeepers.
Other players who might see action, goalkeeper Larry Tukas, who ranked third nationally last year in the NAIA with a .46 goals against average. And defender Ian Fraser, the Comets' second-round draft pick this year from Hartwick College. He continues to work out with the team despite being released earlier this year. There have been changes in the coaching ranks as well. Billy Gazonis, the assistant coach, is gone. And Nicky Nikolic, who played six games in a Comets uniform back in 1983, takes over as assistant coach.
Well, I just think overall he's done a very good job in the training sessions with the players. He's done a very good job there coaching. I think off the field he's done a good job with the players communicating. I think he has a good knowledge of the league and a knowledge of the players. So, I'm just very happy with Nicky in every way. He's done a very good job all around.
The Comets have put a new emphasis on physical conditioning this year and have hired professional cyclist Richard Dawson as their conditioning coordinator. Dawson has worked with the team since the spring, overseeing running and weightlifting workouts mixed with some cycling.
It's quite a bit unconventional for this type of sport, even though it is a conditioning sport, to engage in some of the things we did, such as bike riding, a lot more running than they're used to, and of course lifting some weights and things. So you can imagine the reaction was totally negative for the most part. And you mentioned the spring, a lot of guys felt that it was pretty much punishment to be there. About a week later, they decided it wasn't. We tried to make it a family deal, and pretty soon it was fun. And everybody suffered, and they could all hate me and call me names. And the outcome of it really is we developed a tremendous amount of team unity from it, I think.
And in the front office, Tim Lywicki returns to the Comets as the new team president. Lywicki was the Comets' general manager from 1981 to 1984.
We don't necessarily have to go win every game, but we do necessarily have to go try to win every game. We got to give 100% every night because we have the skill now to win every game. And I think that's the major difference. 3-4 years ago, we went out and tried to win every game, but we knew we were outskilled a lot of times. This year, it's not just us that believe it, but a lot of the other coaches in the league have told us this is the best team Kansas City has ever put together. So I think our expectations on the field are a little higher just because we know the quality of player that we have.
In a moment, Comets head coach Rick Benben will join us to take your calls and comments after this. Coach Rick Benben is back to join us now. We're going to go right to the phone lines and take your calls. So let's go first to Liberty and talk to Denise Gobe. Denise, you're on the air.
Hi, Rick. I have a question. I understand there is quite a bit of animosity between Gino Schiraldi and one of the new players that has came in. He had done some injury to him last season. He was from another team. Has that been reconciled yet?
Oh, sure. I think what you're referring to is Charlie Green, a player we acquired from Pittsburgh, was involved with Gino in a headbutting incident a few years ago. But that's been put to rest a few years ago, so there's absolutely no problem with that.
Yeah, that was a couple at least 2 years ago or more,
right.
Maybe three.
Yeah, three seasons,
three.
I think.
All right, let's go to Miriam. Randy McKinney, you're on the air.
Yeah, Greg, I was wondering, where do you rank the Comets with the rest of the league, say from like first or second? Do you have any idea?
Well, you know, overall talent-wise, I imagine is what you're saying. I think we've really improved. I think we're certainly in the middle of the league talent-wise, and then I think only time will tell if we can, if we're any higher than that. Okay, and I think we have some new players whose performance really will tell how much higher we can go. But certainly, we're at least in the middle, and I have hopes that we can be in the upper. In the upper echelon talent-wise, but we still have too many new players for me who don't have enough track record for me to really be any more specific than that.
Let me ask a question here. Last year when you started the season, you had a lot of new players, and you had great expectations for what you thought was going to be a very good season, and it turned out to be a very disappointing season. Why is this team going to be that much better than last year's team? Why can we be more hopeful?
Okay, well, I think, you know, first of all, last year I think we did have, realistic hopes, and I think we would have, but we just had too many things go wrong. Okay, we lost. But what has happened, I think in many ways that's accelerated our progress as a club. With the salary stabilization, players became available like Goosens, Espinosa, Christensen, good, experienced MISL players were available to us who had not been available in the past. So our pool of good, experienced players was better, and we were able to get a number of those players.
So this is the most talented team you've gone into the season with then?
Oh, without a doubt. You know, and even if you go back to last season, the acquisition of Marhedic, the acquisition of Mitchell, the acquisition of John Bain, all those things together, plus with what we've done the offseason, have certainly made us a much better team.
But as the guy points out, the rest of the league is stronger, too.
No, and the rest, certainly talent-wise, going back a couple years, we were near the bottom. But I think we have gradually come up, and I think we've made some great strides now.
All right, James Beiler, you're next on Sports Extra. Go ahead.
Yeah, Coach Rick Ben. How's it going?
Okay, James, thanks. Isn't you have a wonderful night, all right? Let's go next to John Lehman. John, Kansas City, Kansas. Go ahead.
Hi, Don.
Yeah.
In soccer, when the guy shoots a ball a couple feet wide, why do you say it hit the post?
I'm afraid I don't understand the question. It's considered a shot on goal. And maybe that's what he's talking about. When you shoot on goal, anything in the box area, right, is considered a shot on goal, is it not? That's always been a question around the league as to what is a shot on goal.
Yeah, anything that the statistician has a chance to score a goal. If it would fit in, you know, if it would have went in, if it's on goal, then it's considered a shot. But if it does go wide, then it is not.
Then
a
it
shot
is not
goal.
Considered a shot
no,
on goal because in the, that's the way it should be. Now, in the beginning, I know in the first couple of years of the league, anything that was in the direction of the goal was considered a shot on goal.
Yeah, exactly. There were some really ridiculous shot totals early on, so. You know, it's black and white now and is fairly consistently handled throughout the league.
You go into this season, I think, unquestionably with pressure on you. I think you're being evaluated in the first 10 or 12 games. But I think you made the comment earlier, I'm going in with the best loaded gun I've ever had. You feeling the pressure?
Oh, I think there's pressure in this job or any coaching job all the time. So as far as more pressure than before, I don't think so. If we weren't able to make the improvements of the team, I certainly would be more apprehensive about how the team was going to do. But with the improvements we've made, I feel real comfortable with the team.
You seem very relaxed about what you're doing. I mean, even though you know that the first 12 games are crucial, perhaps to your future. Let's be very candid about this.
Oh, no, sure. But, you know, again, you know, I've said this many times before, too. I know I'm a good coach, and I know if I have a team that's capable of playing with the other teams in the league, we'll do well. And that's never not occurred for me. You know, when I took over the team the first year, we made a few changes and had a great season. Last year, if we wouldn't have had all the problems we had, I think we would have had a strong season. But to be honest, I don't think the team would be as far along as it is now, because I don't think we would have made the changes we did that needed to be made personnel-wise. And I think many of those were accelerated because of problems we had last year.
On defense, you've made some changes. Do you feel you've got more skilled players on defense as far as bringing the ball out of the back? It was an area I know you were very concerned with last year.
No, that's true. I think we've certainly improved there with David Bonchek having another year under his belt. Jens Buss, the Danish player, is a very good passer bringing the ball out. Charlie Green, who we've played in the back, is also has been a front player, is good at bringing the ball out. But more important, and those three players in particular we mentioned all have very good speed. So one area where we've always had a problem in our team, we've been pretty slow, and our overall team speed is much greater, and specifically in the back.
And you couple that with Gino Schiraldi and Clark and people like that, and you can mark people.
Yeah, Gino Schiraldi, Clark, and George Espinosa generally play as our last man, the marking player. And yeah, it is a good combination.
All right. On a team with so many new faces, there is still one familiar face who has been with this team since its very, very beginning. We'll have a close-up look at the man Rick and I were just talking about, Gino Schiraldi, when we come back.
I always try to improve my game, and I'm still, I'm not happy with some parts of my game, and I always try to improve that.
It remains the same. Defender Gino Schiraldi has been the heart and soul of the Comets defense, and the team for that matter, since signing as a free agent back in 1981. Tonight, TV5's Leif Lysick takes a look at the player who has played more games in a Kansas City Comets uniform than any other player in franchise history.
That's an interesting story.
Yes! Schiraldi! And the Comets pull within three.
On a team that returns only six players who started the season last year, Gino Schiraldi is a model of consistency. At age 28, Gino is the only original Comet left on the team.
I feel like I can play another 10 years. No, I just, I've been working real hard just as far as conditioning and maintaining, I try to improve my play. I've been a student of the game. I always try to improve my game, and I'm still, I'm not happy with some parts of my game, and I always try to improve that.
Schiraldi is coming off the best season of his six-year MISL career, setting career highs in goals, assists, and points, and earning a trip to the All-Star game.
I really think in the last 2 years he's made lots of progress. I think that he's improved his game in every manner, and I think he had to do that. You know, the league improved, and I think he's really put a very good effort into improving himself.
It's hard to tell just how important Schiraldi is to the Comets, but over the last 2 years when Gino has been out of the lineup, the Comets are 0-12. But equally important are his contributions off the field. Schiraldi is a tireless promoter for the Comets, with a public appearance schedule equal to any political candidate.
I would say Gino would probably do roughly 100 or so himself, simply because he has other appearances he does on his own that are not necessarily affiliated with the Comets. But Gino and a lot of our other players are very good that when they do appearances on their own for maybe their own business purposes, that they are still representing the Comets very well in the community.
When I'm tired of going out and, you know, doing personal appearances or working in the community, it's time for me to hang up my my shoes, you know, and I enjoy doing it. I believe in that, and I think it brings us a lot closer to the fans, and the fans are aware, you know, what's happening with the players and with the indoor game itself, and when I'm tired of that, and that's when I say, hey, I don't want to play anymore.
But don't look for Schiraldi to hang him up anytime soon. He's in the first year of a three-year contract. Still, Gino is already planning for life after soccer. He'll open a pizza shop in the coming months.
My dream right now is to win the championship, and I'm just preparing myself for the future as far as the pizza business. I have a good partner, and we're looking to open in a couple months. But my number one goal right now is to play soccer and bring the championship team to Kansas City.
Leif Lysick, KCTV5 Sports.
And when we come back, Jack Carey will show you what some former Comets are doing when TV5 Sports Special on the Comets continues.
They do keep me very busy in here. I think it's normal once you've been a player for 15 years that come game time, you feel like you still want to be out there.
As we mentioned, the Comets players have always been a big part of the Kansas City community. Many have made their homes in this area. And tonight, Jack Carey has a report on four former Comets who have remained in the Kansas City area after their playing days and are now living a life without soccer.
That's great.
Former defender Clive Griffiths is still on the Comets' payroll, but now he reports to work in a tie instead of shorts and sneakers.
The term soccer relations operations, soccer relations is I'm basically a liaison between the Comets' office and all the amateur soccer community of Kansas City and the surrounding areas. As far as the operations part of it, the operations is involved with the day of game event, making sure that the arena is ready and prepared for all these weird and wonderful things that the Lightwickies have planned, so it's very, very interesting.
You sure I have everything right?
Yeah, everything's fine.
Have you paid these commissions yet?
No.
Only four players have played more games in a Comets uniform than Kevin Hanlon. The former defender and midfielder now works for Mutual of New York.
It was exciting for me, and I look back with, you know, great memories of that, and the success of it was, I think, had a lot to do with Kansas City, and it was very reflective of Kansas City people, and they just welcomed us with open arms, and it was a great mixture of many things, a great marketing job by the Lightwickies, and the people saw the sport and liked it, and the winning of it wasn't as important, whereas today, right now, people want wins, and that's essential right now for the organization, I feel.
Forward Craig Stahl is now in the insurance business, and defender Bob Bozzotta has his own painting firm. In fact, all four former Comets play on the same indoor team in an Overland Park soccer league.
I guess that's what we have to do. This is the most competitive league that we can play in through Kansas City, and we enjoy the game. We love it, and it keeps us somewhat fit.
I coach an under-12 team my first year after I quit playing, and the past 2 years I helped out at Avila College a little bit with Scott Ferris and his crew out there, and I really enjoyed that. And my business has kind of led me away from that at the present.
Despite their off-field careers, each admitted missing professional soccer.
People have asked me, say, well, do you miss the game? Do you miss playing? I said, certainly I do. I think the thing I miss the most is waking up every morning and going to training and that's my job, and I'm paid to stay fit, and that's the fittest I will ever be was back then, and I just haven't been able to do that, and someday I'll get back to that level, hopefully, but it'll be very difficult.
When it's all starting, when it's all beginning, although they do keep me very busy in here, I think it's normal once you've been a player for 15 years that come game time, you feel like you still want to be out there, but fortunately, that only lasts for a very short time, and they do keep me so busy that, my mind is soon off it, and once the season gets going, I'm so into my work here that's overcome very, very quickly.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that it's instilled in you. I've played since I was so young, and you just never forget that part of your life, and it was a great learning experience, but you have to accept that it's over, and now you just have to be a fan, so it's always support them.
Oh, it's hard. It's something that I really thought I'd play till I was 35, and it got cut short at 25. But out of the buddies of mine that are still playing, I'm rooting for them, and it's fun watching them play.
For Sports Extra, I'm Jack Harry.
Rick, in watching that piece and seeing guys like Kevin Hanlon and Bobby Bozzotta, these guys are good soccer players, but the league has just gotten so much better, hasn't it? That now, just a good soccer player can't make it in this league anymore.
No, that's true, and I think the best way to explain it to people, it would be as if the NBA went from what they are now, 24 teams to 12 teams, and that's really what has happened to professional soccer in this country.
Yeah, in other words, with the outdoor teams, right, folding and everything.
Folding, and they came into our league, and just aren't as many teams.
All right, you've got Jorgen Christensen on your team, a guy who's been a magician as far as assists are concerned. He was a big key to Wichita's offense for so many years. He turns 40 years old. How does Jorgen Christensen fit into Rick Benben's plan, and can he still play at that age?
Well, I think in the three games we've played, he's played very well, and I view Jorgen as a bridge for us while we develop some younger players to play in the midfield and give us some real leadership that I think we needed on the field and in training, and I think he's already brought that to our team and will continue to do so.
Do you spot use him more? You don't put him on a regular shift?
Yeah, well, we play him on a regular shift, but we've used three players in his position, a midfield position, so their time on the field and his time has been a little bit less.
He's been a big help to you, too, in bringing over Busk. We're not quite sure how we pronounce that name. And Jens. Martin Zimmermann, right? Jens.
Yeah, Jürgen helped identify players in Denmark for us. And, you know, when I went over, you know, he certainly was a big help there.
Rick, it's a delight talking to you tonight. I'm sorry we got you on so late, but I'm looking forward to this season as you are. And I know it's easy to say early in the year, this is going to be the best year ever, but I got a feeling it is going to be.
Oh, we hope so, and we're really looking forward to it.
All right, good enough. As we have done, of course, since the Comets came to town 6 years ago, TV5 will televise another full complement of games, both home and away. Now, Jack Harry and I will be in Tacoma December the 10th, as you see, for our first broadcast against the Stars. January 3rd, we'll be at Kemper Arena for the Steamers game. January 10th, we will be in Cleveland. Then in Chicago, the 21st, our TV5 crew will be in Los Angeles on January 31st and on March 13th for games against the Los Angeles Lazers, who, by the way, are off to a really great start. Next on the schedule, the Cleveland Force, March 25th, then back to Kemper the 28th for the Steamers, and we'll conclude our coverage in April with games in Wichita and then in Minnesota. And then, hopefully, we'll be announcing a playoff schedule for you as well. Well, that's going to do it for this Rated Tough special. Our thanks again to Rick Benben for staying up late with us tonight, and a special thanks to Comets Public Relations Director Tim Bryant for all his help on this show. For the TV5 Sports Department and for our producer, Leif Lysik, I'm Don Fortune. Thanks for joining us, and good night.